I'd like to call our budget hearing for Tuesday, May 17th to order. And we have three commissioners here today and two absent and haven't heard from either one of them, so not sure what that is. First, we will have Mr. Bill Vincent from the Historical Museum.
Well, gentlemen, on behalf of the museum's board of directors, I certainly want to take this opportunity to thank you all and also the citizens of Alamance County for your continued support, particularly as we anticipate our 40 years in operation. As you all know, we were established in 1975 and then formally opened in 1976 as a bicentennial project, so we're approaching our anniversary. We've grown during this period of time. We now hold in trust for the citizens of Alamance County a collection of items that whose value I think probably exceeds $1 million. We have restored a collection of antique buildings, the oldest of which dates to about 1790. And I think we've had a successful year this past year. We ended the year in the black, as you saw from our financial reports, and that's always good. We personally this year, our staff gave guided tours to over 14,000 people during the course of the year. And our records show that those people came from 50 states and 14 foreign countries. Sometimes I wonder how the people find us out on Highway 62, but they end up coming out there, and we appreciate that very much. During the course of the year, we received two grants totaling $6,000. One of those enabled us to produce some additional signage for the property, informational signs that are in front of a number of the buildings. And the second grant will enable us to produce by the end of the year a quilt project that we're currently working on antique quilts. We did bring during the course of the year to the area several well-known speakers and people of note. One of those was the designer Alexander Julian, who presented for us at the Alamance Country Club. And you know, he's interested in the development of color, and that was directly associated with the Alamance plaids that were developed here, the earliest commercially produced cotton materials made in the southern United States. We also had Amy Wood Pasquini, who is one of the editors of Our State magazine, who presented for us. We brought the noted Chagall scholar Vivian Jacobson here, and she presented an event in conjunction with the Arts Council or Alamance Arts for us. We also had the noted historian Elliot Engel, who spoke about the Vanderbilt family in North Carolina. And we just have had Jim Dodson, who's the editor of the O. Henry magazine, to provide us with a program. So we've had a number of important speakers. On May the 25th of this year, the museum will, I think, get some national exposure because David Holt will begin to film a series for his PBS program, The State of Music, and that series will be filmed, a portion of it, at the museum, and will be then broadcast nationally to PBS stations around the United States. So we look forward to that. And as I said, he'll begin that process on May the 25th. We painted our summer kitchen during the course of the year, and that's one of the things that I had mentioned last time when I was here that I hoped that we would be able to accomplish during the course of the year. So that was taken care of, and we have upgraded our computer systems as well. We produced a number of programs during the course of the year. We hosted the annual garden tour. We hosted our annual Christmas tea and greenery sale. We held our annual American Girl doll tea. We had a spring educational tea back in March, and we also hosted History Day for Leadership Alamance. We also produced over 40 educational pages for the museum Facebook page, and I would encourage some of you to visit that and maybe learn a little bit more about the county in doing so. So I think we've had a successful year. Last year, we received from the county $82,000, which we very much appreciated. This year in our budget, we are asking for an increase of $2,000 to $84,000. And that increase, we hope to use to construct a handicap ramp on our 1872 Granary building. That building is oftentimes used now for classroom facility when we have school groups and other groups who come out for lectures and things of that nature. And because of the nature of the building, there are a set of high steps to get into the building, and it's difficult for some people to access the building. So we think that process, we've had some estimates drawn, and we believe it's going to cost us between $6,000 and $7,000 to produce a handicap ramp, and we're asking the county to maybe contribute about $2,000 to that process. So our request this year is for $84,000. Any questions?
Okay. The Granary building, that's the one up closest to the road on
yes, sir. That's the two-story building, right. And it was built in 1872 by John and Emsley Coble, who were local vernacular builders. And there are a number of Coble buildings around in the community. Mm-hmm. We even have their tools, which were given to us by family members. And the tools are kind of interesting because every one of the tools has carved into it either EC or JC for Emsley Coble or John Coble. And then there's a huge tool chest that's almost as long as one of these tables that all the tools fit into. So, but that building is a multi-purpose building for us now. We do sometimes exhibits in that building, but then a lot of our programming.
It's a well-done building. Y'all renovated and done a lot of work on that. And
I had one question about, you mentioned working with school groups. What could you describe the formal programming that you have? Yeah.
Well, for fourth graders and eighth graders, they generally get a tour of the museum just as anybody else, and the classes set up, an appointment to bring the kids over. We do have a traveling trunk that we take into the school system when we're requested to, and that includes a number of artifacts that can generate conversation with the kids. For instance, we have a swatch of the Alamance plaid material in there, and we begin by, asking them, what is a plaid? What do we mean when we say plaids, and so forth? And then that enables us to talk about that. This year, all of the first and second graders from E.M. Holt School came to the museum for Easter egg hunts. That was back, and they, the parents came out and hid eggs on the museum grounds and so forth. So a variety of different kinds of activities take place with those kids.
Thank you.
Very good. Well, it's quite a wonderful thing what you did preserving the history of Alamance County there.
Thank you. I do appreciate it. And I would say that our assistant now has just received her master's degree also, so we appreciate her. She's a non-traditional student, but while she's been working at the museum, she's been going to UNCG and has just received a master's degree in historic preservation, so that helps us out a great deal too. So we thank you all.
Okay, Ms. Sherry Hooks, we're
Susan Roberts. We're
going to
tag
team. Oh, okay. I see how that works.
Teamwork.
You wouldn't happen to know the page number that you're
talking
about? I do. 102.
Yeah, I have one.
One on the blue folders.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Well, no, I don't have page numbers on
this. No, this is one we got this stuff.
Yeah. Right.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
I don't know if that's off the
room. That explains it. Thank you.
This morning before you is our request for the Employee Insurance Fund. As you're aware, we are self-funded, which means we pay for our own premiums and our claims. That request is found on page 101. We are asking to allocate $8.5 million. Currently, we are paying $498.75 per employee per month in premiums, and we are wanting to raise that amount up to $600,000 to coincide with our Employee Insurance Fund policy to raise that fund balance back up.
$600 a month.
And most of that is just due to the claims, that extra claims that we've had throughout the year and put us in the negative at the end of the year.
Yes, so by taking it to $600 a month, that will, as you'll remember, the board approved our employee insurance fund policy to get those premiums back up so that we could have a stronger fund balance, because currently we do not have one.
Okay, well, makes sense to me. So, anybody have any comments and questions?
Do you see a problem down the road, I mean, as far as the fund balance and keep growing the population as far as the employees and all that?
With our fund balance, we had, at one point in time, it was a pretty healthy fund balance in there, Commissioner Parker. And when we went through the recession, we were trying to figure out ways to not impact the general fund as much. And so we cut the premiums, and just through the course of those last few years, our claims went higher than what we had anticipated. We had some very heavy, high-priced claims that the county was responsible for, and that ate into our fund balance. And last year, when we closed out the fiscal year, we were actually in the negative, and the LGC did, it was an audit finding in our report. But they work with us because it is an internal insurance fund, so we were able just to have a plan in place, which was a commitment by the board to, over time, raise those premiums back up so that we can begin building our fund balance. And we are working with our third-party administrator, the Pierce Group. They look at, they evaluate our claims, they evaluate our premiums to see if there's anything we can do, if there are any programs that we need to implement to help offset those costs. The employee clinic has been a great savings to the county, because that has reduced a lot of our claims for our employees going to their own doctors when there are services that can be provided at the employee clinic that's not a cost to them, and it's a reduced cost to the county.
Very good.
Do you have any numbers on that total savings? Maybe Sherry could answer that.
It's about 350.
It's around 350.
And that's wise. After we, our
yeah,
payout
I've
for
been,
it.
I've tried it, and I haven't looked at the spreadsheet
right
lately, but it's around, each year it's around 380,000.
Well, another good thing I like about it is convenient to the employees. They can
yes
get in, get out, and don't get tied up at a doctor's office.
Did all that
exactly.
Yesterday, I didn't come in for the day, got a Z-Pack, felt better. That's the reason I was at the meeting last night.
Right.
So, or that could be a bad thing, getting back to work early.
So. All right. Any comments? Anything else? Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Sherry.
Thanks, sir.
All right. Next, we have the Register of Deeds. Who's going to do this? You doing it or Cheryl?
I'm doing it with Cheryl,
yeah. Oh, okay.
For Sheriff to speak. Any of y'all don't know me, I'm Hugh Webster, Register of Deeds. And I guess you have the budget in front of you.
Mm-hmm. We do.
Now, the top part of this budget is personal services. That's not our doing. Somebody somewhere else did that. From last year, we were led to believe that after we studied the pay here, but particularly in the Register of Deeds office, we were way behind other Register of Deeds and other employees of the county.
Right.
And you remember, Eddie?
I do. I remember.
We were told that we had to take this in steps.
Right.
And my employees got a raise last year, and I appreciate that. I was on the verge of, a lot of other people were trying to hire my employees, and they stayed. The only reason they stayed, I figured, was because they loved me and loved the location. And Alamance County, I got to tell you, Alamance County, some really good people there. And you heard me say this before, I've lived and worked on four continents. I never had a better staff than what I got right here in Alamance County. And they must be loyal, because before last year's raise. They really should have
stuck with
them. They should have left. They were surrounding registers of deeds were trying to hire them. But anyway, that top number there should be 5% instead of 2.2%. Now, one thing that we've done, and this is really important, we have contracted with Logan. We used to be with COT. We've contracted with Logan, and that includes Logan's contract is $7,000 a month, a little higher than it was with COT. But we don't buy any machines, and we don't service any machines, and our IT people, or MIS people, where are they upstairs? They don't, Logan takes care of this, okay? Now there's been some, anytime you make that big a change, there's gonna be some false steps. I mean, there's some things go wrong, and we're still working on this transition. And, but the fact is, we're saving at least one person in the IT, because they don't have to come, they don't come to our place. Now, one thing that has happened, we were out of service, I believe it was about 2 hours in this past year. I hear that y'all were out of service over here about a week.
Yeah, yeah.
Not a week.
What was it?
About a day, I think.
24 hours.
Yeah.
24 hours.
Yes, sir.
But it took a week to figure out how much we lost right. And try to get back to where we were.
Well.
Probably less than 24 hours, yeah. But we had a crash, but it was not a week.
Yeah.
For us, an hour seemed like forever, because everything we do is dependent upon those computers working.
Yeah.
Now, one thing that we're doing is we, our space, we're running out of space, rapidly running out of space. But I have, ever since I've been there, planned for this time and what we're gonna do. And you know, there's been some discussion, Eddie, you remember, about a new building?
Right.
I will restate the fact that I do not want a new building. That is a but if you're gonna use old buildings, you gotta maintain them.
Right.
We have finally got that carpet replaced. We did it Labor Day weekend. I had contracted with 4 strong arms to move the heavy stuff on Saturday, and we had to do it when we were closed, because we couldn't do this carpet with people coming in. And out of the 4 that were supposed to show up, only 2 of them showed up, and they were moving one of those tall cabinets, metal cabinets, weighs at least 300 pounds, it's about 6 feet tall, and it got out of balance and started falling on them. And that's when I stepped over and caught it, and like that, and I heard it pop in my back. Been hell ever since. Mm. I don't know if I'd do that again now. I think I just let the cabinet fall on my head. They probably would have been all right anyway. But I've had 2 surgeries since then, 2 back surgeries.
Wow.
It ain't no fun. But anyhow, we need to move on toward getting my employees' help in line with county, other county help, and other registered deeds help. We have, to give you a report on what we have achieved, we painted the entire inside the building. Part of that was done by jail inmates, and part of it was done by a professional paint crew. And it looks a lot better. It's a lot brighter. And that carpet was so bad that it was causing respiratory distress on some of us in the building. It had so much dirt in it that you could probably plant a crop of corn in it. But that, when we were pulling that carpet out that Labor Day weekend, it was terrible. I mean, it was just piled of sand and dirt. But it looks much better now. The ramp that goes from the 118 building into the 116 building is a different color. And so far, I don't think anybody's fallen since we changed that color of that ramp, have we?
That transitions like that are catchers, for sure.
Anyway, this contracted services automation fund is something that the legislature put in to assure that registers of deeds could have money for automation. Well, the removal of that carpet, we have scanners. When you bring a deed in there, or a deed of trust, we scan it. Now, just in the past year, these deliveries of these deeds and deeds of trust documents are coming in more and more electronically.
From the attorney office?
Yes. Yeah. And that has cut down on the traffic in our office drastically. You know, you don't see many people there, but it's coming in through the computer. What happens is the deed goes first electronically to the tax office, and the tax office checks to see if there's any delinquent taxes on it, any past due taxes, and if not, they sign off on it and send it over to us so we can record it then. So I think it's going to be a good thing. It scares me to not to get that actual piece of paper in my hand. That's because I'm old fashioned, Eddie. You know.
I understand.
But I believe it's going to be all right. We've as long as we can keep those computers up and running.
Right.
And Logan is a vendor, the contractor.
That's the base computer system that you work with.
And we kept one of the servers that we had bought, that the county had bought, in order to have a full backup server. And it's supposed to be now, if something happens with a server that's being used, we can just switch over to the backup server. Backup server is an old server that we had been using before, and we had leased it, and then we bought it from the lessor.
Do you back up every night?
Back up all day.
Oh, okay.
Every night.
Every so often.
Now, is it going to work, Roger? I don't know.
You don't know till you have to pull it back up and see what's there.
I guess,
right?
I could walk in there and pull the plug on that.
and find out,
but I don't have the guts to do that.
Do y'all have off-site storage or that?
Yeah.
Okay.
In Greensboro and in Raleigh.
Okay.
And
that could be a major disaster.
Maybe over here, I don't know.
In one spot. Yeah.
Anyway, this automation fund, if you read the law itself, and I'm not an accountant, I was one for 45 years, and that's enough. Maybe you can read it, Roger, and tell us what it means. But it was set up so that registers of deeds would have money for improvements. The carpet that was there was worn out. People were tripping on it, and it was nasty, nasty, and it was affecting my breathing and some other people's breathing. So I'm so glad to get that stuff out of there and get that new carpet in. It looks good. People who come in compliment us on it, and what's left to do as far as maintenance goes, the outside of that building needs cleaning up. You can do that, can't you?
You let us know.
We got a department that can. Yeah.
I just let you know. I have complained and asked for a cleanup on the outside to our maintenance people.
Have you put a work order in?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'll check on that.
It's so long ago that I don't remember it.
Yeah, follow up on that.
Yeah.
I'll do that right now.
But it really, I think probably a good pressure washing on most of it would help, would take care of it. They have fixed the overhang at front, replaced the lights. They've done a lot. Our maintenance people got a big job. And anyway, you will see. Is everybody's utilities going up? I swear, it's just terrible.
It's, yeah. Yep.
There's a line item down at in the second section. It's a down, the third one down. Actual is $18,500, and we're asking for $11,000. Now that is our number. I mean, that's what we want. Now the reason that it's down, and I don't know how much down it's going to be, is we are, I hate to use this term, going paperless. We were out of space. We're still having in the land records department, we have hopefully we will be able to deal with this running out of space by the fact that we're doing digital recording. I mean, digital record keeping, computers. And the part that we haven't addressed yet is what's called vitals, births, marriages, and deaths. And we're out of space there. We have, and in those records, we like to keep actual hard copy records. In some cases, that might be the only copy we got. Now, we were doing computerized records in vitals, but we're also keeping paper copies. Plans for the coming year, and this is not much money, is I want us to have, we keep DD-214s, discharges, and we keep them in the safe, because that is not public record until they've been over there for 80 years. When it's been in there for 80 years, I can give you a copy of it, Bob. But
I'll come by there and get it.
Okay.
It's been that long, right? We're approaching that.
Anyway. What else have we got to deal with, Cheryl?
Could I ask a question?
Yes, sir. Mr.
Webster, in the expense section, about almost towards the bottom, there are two lines that are similar. One says contracted services, and one says contracted services - automation fund. So I think you explained the automation fund, and that was set up through legislation.
Yeah.
Right. And to help automate things. What's the other contracted services? It's for $100,000 you're requesting this year.
Yeah, it's what comes out of, it comes out of the budget. That part comes out of the budget. It comes out of the county money.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, what are we contracting for with that number?
Computer service.
Okay. That's what you were explaining earlier, that you don't use much of our MIS upstairs.
That's right.
So that's what that is.
That's right. And in our work, you said 24 hours. 24 hours might have been 20. It may as well have been 24 days, because I think if I was out of service for 24 hours, I'd run away. Because that's, for us, we have to record that deed, mm-hmm. and that deed of trust.
Yeah, because they won't turn that money loose at the attorney's office.
That's exactly right.
Do that.
But that's different than the automation fund, because I think of computers too.
Yeah, well, it is computer. Here's a description. I don't know if you got a copy of this or not.
No.
No, we don't.
Commissioner Byrd, if you'll look on page 118, it'll have the breakdown for just the contracted service line.
Okay, thank you.
Right. You're welcome.
And there's some that probably can go back into the automated line item other than just regular county contracted services as well, since there's some computer-generated stuff that you can use automated funds for. So we'll get with Ms. Webster to clarify some of these.
Yeah, stuff. And one of my questions is, as you're... I keep hearing this, we're out of space. Is there any way the county can use a secure area to put some of these documents to off-site store them? I mean, is that...
We do off-site storage. I think some of the issues that he is having with some of the vital records, I don't know if we can do off-site or not.
I'm thinking like deeds, those type of things. I mean, everybody's doing electronic now.
Right. We do have a company that we do off-site storage with, but it may, the question will be is how secure that they have to be, especially the deeds and those vital documents.
But I mean, you've got a paper you've got a computer there, you've got off-site storage electronic, and then you've got a paper copy should it come down to it. I mean, what would happen if we had a total burnout at the register deeds?
Well, like a fire, you mean?
What if it just burned the whole building down? What would you do in that situation? You speaking of being down?
Run away.
Okay.
No, I'm serious. We
I mean, you do have backups.
Well, yeah, we have backups.
Yeah.
It wouldn't be fun, but we do have
backups.
Now, as to your question. We have contracted this year with what became known as it had another name before, but now it's Iron Mountain.
And we are a storage company that stores records and they have some kind of.
We're just storing tapes, notebooks.
I got you.
Mm-hmm. Now we got a contract. We can store books with them.
Right.
And we are in the process of changing the our plats, Commissioner Bottle, Mr. Chairman, is they've been stored horizontally in these flat cabinets. I'm sure you come down and looked at them. They're not good ways to do it, because people come in, surveyors, lawyers come in and look at it.
Yeah.
And they don't put them back in the right drawer, they don't put them back in the right order. And so what we're doing is transitioning to a different kind of actual storage of the plats. And we these plats are all scanned in. We got electronic copies of them, or digital copies, whatever you want to call them. But they are not, we feel like that these actual Mylar plats should be kept and preserved. So what we're doing is, and it's big money too, is we're going to a different storage system. So it's all vertical. And you know, those horizontal storage, we're transitioning away from them. And plus, we're trying to get the old stuff stored so that it's easy to get to, it's safer, it's, and these cabinets are, if you believe this, I got some real estate setting, waterproof and fireproof.
Right.
I don't think so. I don't think, I think that a fire or a flood in there would, it would take it a long time to get to the contents of these new cabinets that we're getting. But what it is I tell you what, let me show you on the 26th.
I've got your invitation, and I'm RSVPing right now, so
all right.
Put that down, sure. And you in charge of RSVPs, I think.
Christmas.
Oh, okay, well, pass it on.
Each of us has our own job. Okay. She does too.
All right, well, we look forward to that. Thank you for your presentation. Any other questions?
Well, I just noticed that it looks like with the fees that the Register of Deeds generates, it covers most of their expenses.
It does. They do.
In 14-15, we actually generated more fees than expenses.
Right.
Like a profit center.
Yeah.
Changed last year.
And hopefully we will this year. Our work over there is a stethoscope on the economy. When we're busy, when stuff is getting recorded,
we're busy.
That's right.
Exactly.
That's good.
Yep.
And that bottom part of this budget request is may or may not be accurate. You can't tell. I mean, I can't tell because sure. I don't know. I don't know how much building is going to happen.
A lot of it's forecast.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Any more questions?
Very good.
Okay.
Thanks. Appreciate it.
If y'all got any questions that you think about to.
Now, how are you doing as far as working? Are you able to go in on a regular basis? Or
go in, but sitting up for 8 hours at a time really works on my back.
I got you.
And, I can walk easier than I can sit or stand, but I swear it. I don't know if I'm telling myself this or it's getting better.
Yeah. Yeah.
Damn, what a trip. This
is
terrible.
Tough stuff, isn't it?
I've had two surgeries, and when they did the first one, the damage was about this size, about this big. And I had a doctor's appointment the day of the ice storm, and I slipped up and I slammed into my own car and wound up having another surgery.
Well, sorry to hear about your stuff there as far as personal and physical. So.
When y'all were talking about the insurance, I thought, hell, a big part of that is my fault.
We're getting ready to hear. They're going to give. No, I'm just kidding. They can't do that.
I think it's called the Hugh effect.
The Hugh. Sure. It's the Hugo storm comes through.
I'm going to tell you one thing. I sure as hell wouldn't have done that deliberately.
And that's true. All righty.
Any
Thank
questions
you,
y'all got? Yeah. Call me. And the whole time that I was out, I was this far from two telephones, and the instructions to all of my employees was to call me. And Cheryl called me not every day, but I mean I was in touch with the office, and God, I was getting worried now. They were operating so well, I was worried that they wouldn't need me anymore.
Cheryl, thanks for keeping him in order over there.
She is really good.
I know she is. Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Sorry.
Okay.
Sure.
Next, Thank we're going to have Susan Roberts and Rhonda Markle, if you will come forward and tell us about this workman comp and property insurance.
Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
You the first batter up today?
Do what?
You the first batter up?
Yeah, might as well be, right? Commissioner Parker, my name is Rhonda Morkel. I work in the finance department. I don't believe we've had the pleasure. I do the payroll and property and liability and a few other odds and ends. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the property and liability. We're somewhat self-funded on that program. We have a high retention program where we carry high deductibles, trying to offset the cost of what we're spending on property and liability insurance. Right now, this year, we're doing pretty well. We're staying in the black so far. Keep your fingers crossed for the next month and a half that we all keep it between
the
ditches.
Right there.
That's exactly right. We've only had one, I won't say big claim, but it's going to, you know, we're going to spend a little bit of money on it. It's just an accident, you know, things happen, and we've been very fortunate this year with those. We are looking, our carrier's looking at another company within his purview, and if that comes out, then we'll have a little more coverage. This company is also going to offer a lot of preventative programs for us, like distracted driving, things like that. And if we do wind up going with them, we'll, you know, the bottom line is the dollar figure as to whether we move or not. And if we do wind up with that, we will be utilizing those programs countywide and hopefully making all of us more safe and doing what we need to do to save taxpayer dollars.
Right.
That's pretty much where we stand. You have any questions?
Mr. Chairman, if I could, I really want to thank the work that Rhonda does in finance and also Clyde and Ben. Part of what we did is we have a much, much higher deductible now. And the reason why we have the higher deductible is we don't pay out on fraudulent claims.
Oh, okay.
And we've had issues in the past when our deductible was low. The insurance company would just basically pay out.
And say, here it is.
And that would make our rates continually rise. But now we're in the position that we don't just pay because somebody makes a claim.
Right.
Rhonda does a lot of investigation. Clyde does a lot of work. Ben does a lot of work, really, to keep our insurance costs where they need to be. And I just wanted to publicly
thank Rhonda. I'm guessing our employees are up to date that they have to report these accidents.
Yes, sir.
That's part of the time limits.
She does a wonderful job of making sure. And when we have accidents or minor issues, that Rhonda make sure everybody's aware of them.
Well, when we went to this higher retention program, Clyde and I worked really closely together. Our insurance company knows Mr. Albright,
okay,
and knows that he is going to take a significant role.
Right.
We've had some claims where in the past we've had some accidents with our emergency service personnel. They're running emergency traffic, people hit our vehicles, and they automatically think that we're going to pay out for that. That's not the case. As you know, that's a law that you need to move out of the way. We don't care if your radio's blaring or you're distracted or what, you're going to get out of our emergency service personnel's way. It's not only for their own safety, but our people. And Mr. Albright certainly
goes out from when we have somebody else involved.
Yeah. And with this possibility of this new company that we're looking at, they also are aware from the start that we will play an active role in the coverage and the claims.
I think that's a good position for our county to do that.
Yes. We had one carrier years ago that would just pay it out, and they were like, really?
Yeah.
We had a little leg to stand on there.
Do we, I call this risk management, where we actually track claims and trend claims, look for commonalities, what happens over time?
We don't technically track claims because we don't have a per se risk manager to devote 100% of the time to that. We do keep an eye on what's coming in, and we do address things. The sheriff's office has been really good. Sheriff Johnson's probably going to kill me for saying this. They haven't had a bad accident in a while. And he is stepping up with his training. And, you know, we see most of the things that come into play are emergency service with vehicles. We have some slip and falls. And, you know, we do investigate and make sure it's if it's something that we're negligent on, like if we have some broken pieces of pavement, somebody steps in, we do address those right away. You know, if it's somebody who's just falls down in the yard because they're out there playing with one of their children at Family Justice, no, we don't.
Right.
You know, that's, I'm a klutz. I'm not going to sue the county because I'm a klutz. We don't per se do that, but we do keep an eye on what's going on and address it as we see it happening. So.
Very good. Well, I think training is very important. I was talking to Brian the other day. He went with the EMS to do a little driving of it. I think he wiped out a lot of cones, but anyhow.
Yeah. We don't want, Brian's not driving EMS.
No, Brian will not be emergency service personnel.
We love Brian. Brian ain't driving
EMS. He's not driving an EMS truck, nor a fire truck.
Nor a fire truck, or.
We will let him go back to the park and drive a gator all
day
long.
Okay, very good, very good.
But any other questions? Okay.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
There's a lot of dead cones out there. So.
And I'm guessing Susan's going to do the next one. She popped right up.
We'll do the workers' comp. We are not experiencing an increase to that fund this year. We would have it still budgeted for $900,000 for expense-wise. What we are going to see is an increase of funding from the general fund. We reduced those premiums last year because of our healthy fund balance that we had in workers' comp. And because we had the workers' comp healthy fund balance, we were able to transfer funds from the workers' comp to the insurance fund to cover that shortage that we had for fund balance. But what this will do is we'll reinstore those funds as well as maintaining the fund balance that we currently have.
Okay, with that. That's all we
thank
need.
You.
Thank you, Susan. We're going to keep it easy on you. Next, we have the rescue squad, Nick Martin.
Brad's actually.
Who's that? Good morning.
I'm Brad Christman. I'm assistant chief of rescue.
Oh, okay.
We have, there's no contract in place with the county. We're set rate anyway, so we're giving you a breakdown of what we have in the contract and the amount we receive every year. Start at the top 30 paid personnel. We've got two people 7 days a week, 8 to 5, paying them at a rate of $10 an hour. Capital reserve, $25,000 is our effort to put aside for heavy rescue apparatus, replacing equipment, any major upgrades to the building, we need repairs. Uniforms, $3,000 approximately. This is the daily uniforms that our personnel wear. Of course, when we get into replacing our turnout gear, generally speaking, we do go over that amount somewhat. We also use a matching grant from the state that we generally apply for every year. It's a matching grant of $25,000. So we try to use that to offset the cost of our overage on our uniforms. The $800 on the Rescue Association dues, like I said, there is just the dues for benefits, scholarships, and compensation back to our members. Very good expense, and we have $800. It really returns to our members. I myself just got a $2,000 scholarship for the third time, I found out earlier this week. So it really pays back to our members that are, you know, furthering our education. The maintenance on the vehicles, $9,500. It's a rough estimate cost. Of course, that fluctuates every year depending on the vehicle itself and what, like you said, Brian, what we might tear up. The equipment maintenance, $4,200. Some of our equipment, air packs, some of our Hurst equipment has to be tested annually. Goes through those tests to ensure its readiness and the safety on using it for our personnel and the people that we're using it on. $8,500 in training. There, as it says, textbook training, paid for classes and instructors. Fortunately, we do have several certified instructors at Rescue, so we can do a lot of our training in-house. So it's really cut back over the past few years of out-of-town training, but we still have to do that for some specialty classes that it just costs too much to have somebody come here to do. New equipment, $36,000, pagers, AEDs, stuff that has to be replaced every year. The currently, the radios are approximately $4,500 each. We're looking right now at another company. The state contract with Motorola is finally up for the Viper's communication system that we use. So two other companies that we're kind of testing out, they're a little bit less than that $4,500, but we're still trying to balance out paying what you get for. Excuse me, getting what you pay for. The pagers, they stay at $350 each. They really don't change. Office equipment, as you see there, is typical what you have for an office. The building grounds maintenance, $38,000. Keep on the grounds. The big thing we're looking at there, the parking lots at base 1, 2, and 3 are there in desperate need. The where the EMS maintenance center is on Rescue's building, the dumpster that they just moved from there, there's a foot crater there from where the truck came in overtime year and year and over the years. And that's got to be replaced sometime soon because you can't even get up in the lot right there. For next one, the capital needs here, the new heavy rescue crash truck. See, the cost to replace that truck is $550,000. Currently, if you're not familiar, a grant was sent in, the Duke Endowment Fund. We're still waiting to hear back from them. All the paperwork was submitted. And in fact, we talked with Brian last week. He was supposed to get in touch with them. We're still waiting to hear back from them. So hopefully that truck will come at their expense and not ours. And that was also in collaboration with using it with ACC and Alamance Regional. New ambulance there, cost of that, the one we have, I believe it was 89, 26 years old. It beats you to death when you get in the back of it. They're not comfortable rides anyway, but when you get to 26 years old, they have no shock, no suspension, nothing left. That cost of the place in that was $150,000, and we're currently looking for a way to replace that, whether it be something, you know, used, remounted somehow. The backside just breaks down part-time personnel. As explained earlier, maintenance there, $38,000 again. It just further broke down some of the resurfacing, restriping. And I'll leave it open to any questions you have.
How many calls a year do you get when our units are busy?
When EMS is tied up? I think last year we transported just under 100 patients. However, when we put on what they call standby, when those are busy, that on average is 2 to 3 times a day. Last week, one day, we were on standby. We didn't transport anybody, but there was almost 5 hours where there was no available unit in the county. Luckily, as soon as a 911 call was coming in, there was one just getting ready to leave the hospital. Our call volume to date, the last ticket I did 2 days ago was 528
calls. Past fiscal year?
Since January.
Since January, okay.
528 calls. That'd be for including those transports, including wrecks, including the, we cover all medical calls in the city of Graham, since Graham Fire does not.
Okay.
Includes that.
So you pick up all of Graham's medical calls?
All their medical calls. Yeah, they're the only fire department in the county that does not run medical calls. So we are covering the city of Graham.
Do you still have the dive rescue squad?
Yes, do you have them. And they're included in this training.
And overall training.
Everything. That is a whole unit in itself. We do have a swift water team, dive rescue, still water. We've all combined into one category, water rescue. So they're cross training so much, we just put them all together to make them more efficient.
Just out of curiosity, with the activity of so many more people getting on our Hall River and kayaking and everything, are you seeing a large increase or more of an increase?
It is more of an increase.
Rescues.
Week before last, they pulled two off the river.
Okay.
Yeah, they, the faster it goes, the more rain we get, the harder it goes.
That's right.
And I think it's also, number one, we want to thank what Rescue does, and I think the new contract that we have has worked out well for both parties. Also, you know, the county does the fuel for Rescue. We also do the maintenance for Rescue. I think, do we do the utilities?
The bases that like the metal truck utilizes.
Yes. Yeah.
Where we have a joint venture there.
Right.
Yeah, they call us.
And what else do we pick up?
There's some medical supplies.
Yeah, some of the medical supplies. So we have a really good relationship with Rescue, right. and there's a lot of things that the county does that are not really shown through their budget, but as far as joint relationships that
that's
we work
good.
Together on.
That's good, y'all can work together.
And Craig, thank you. That is a tremendous burden off of us. You know, we assist EMS in turn.
Right.
You know, that
right.
we it, replace our stuff. And I'll say the cost of the billing that goes to that patient with their bill for that transport goes back to the general county fund through EMS. It does
right.
not come back to Rescue.
Right. And one of the things, we're going to talk about convalescent. And there may be some options for increased revenue for Rescue as well. And we really do appreciate their willingness to put two people on duty 7 days a week. And that has really been a great benefit, not just for Rescue, but for the entire county. So we want to thank you for that as well. Thank you.
Well, I did attend the 60th
yes,
anniversary.
Yes, yes. Yeah, coming by. Yeah.
So
yeah.
That was very enlightening for me to see everything that you do and how you interface with
we saw the
county.
Table where we've been and where
we're
yeah. where going. One question, I mean, I hear you asking for an ambulance to replace the 89 model. Do we have any in our fleet that is a potential for?
There could be some possibilities. We're doing some remounts this year. I don't know if we're getting a full box truck this year, but I think they kind of always have taken the quote unquote leftovers.
Yeah.
So and y'all like the stepchildren in the emergency
yeah,
department.
Yeah,
right?
they're not they're the stepchild, not the redhead one.
Right.
Right. But so we
here at all.
Northern O'Hare. But we will try to work with them on any type of time we have.
I know we were looking at possibly
right.
doing some
remounts. Yes, sir.
I didn't know.
They have always in the past, and
right.
probably 3 years ago, there was one that became available, but
it wasn't worth the effort.
We don't give them top. We wear it out first.
Yeah.
That's the way all of our county
yeah.
vehicles
when it's
are.
Yeah. 150,000 miles already. It's not worth restriping it, repainting it, and then the safety issue.
Right.
Comes
right. Well, and that's
yeah.
very important. Okay.
I'm confused though as to what is actually being asked out of our budget. Is it because it shows 100,000, but this
200.
List that you went over was a lot more than
oh,
that?
Oh, yeah, that's a, right. a capital thing, and that's what I'm saying. Hopefully, that grant,
right,
the duking down,
if you get
the
grant
for the
from
truck,
Duke,
hopefully,
then,
we're.
Yeah.
They have other revenue that they raise on their own and other grants. Just their portion from the county they're asking for right now is 100,000.
Okay.
Okay. And now, do you have to match those grants with any county or? In-house funds.
The, the matching grant we get from the state association is $25,000. So basically, they pay that up, and then we put up the $25,000. So we're getting everything basically half price.
I got you.
Then the Duke endowment for the truck, hopefully, we get that's not cool. That's just
straight out.
That's
grant.
Just,
yeah.
Here you go. Make good of it.
There you right. go. Well, very good. All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, next we got Kerry Worthy, the Art Association. How are you, sir?
Good morning.
Morning.
How are y'all doing?
Great. Good.
Yeah. So the Arts Council's budget is pretty much the same. I think the increase is that we're having the big Chihuly exhibition this next year. It starts July 1 and goes through October 15th. And we hope that's a Wooten exhibition, and we hope to have anywhere between 35,000 and 51,000 people through to see the exhibit. So we're very excited about that. That exhibit, of course, we have to do some major things to the facility to bring it up to what the contract requires for that exhibit. We don't have any increases in salaries or anything other than what we're, we continue to do on a regular basis.
The exhibit, what did you expect the traffic to be?
Well, we're hoping between 35 to 51. 35,000 is what we did with the Seward Johnson exhibit.
Mm-hmm, I was gonna
ask. And 51,000 is what we did with the Art of the Brick.
Okay.
So somewhere in between there, it'd be great to even do more than that, but the Art of the Brick was aimed at children.
That was two years ago.
Yes, 2 years ago. This one is aimed more at adults. It is, I don't know if you know, but Dale Chihuly is a glass blower. He's very famous. This is a private collection. It hasn't been seen very much because it's a private collection. It won't be seen anywhere but us on the East Coast. And we have the main kind of showpiece is a chandelier, but it's five pieces, two that hang and three that sit on the floor. So it's considered one piece. And then we have 40 some vessels. They were all made in Venice, so it's called Chihuly the Venetian. He went to Venice and worked with the Venetian artists. So it's a collaborative where some of the, there's cherubs and other things on the pieces that were made by the Venetian artists. So anyway, it's something that no one will else can see in North Carolina or the surrounding states except if they come here to Alamance County.
Okay, so in the budget this year, you're asking for $1,000
over correct.
What you did last year.
Mm-hmm.
And I would think that Graham would receive some benefit out of that too when folks come here to visit, right?
That's right. We had people from all over the country come for Art of the Brick, and we assume that we will have that. We've already had phone calls. We've already had buses that have scheduled to bring people from their surrounding areas and out of state. So we know that the Alamance County businesses will generate some funds from this exhibition.
The City of Graham contribute to your?
The City of Graham does contribute. This year for the Chihuly, we also specifically for that exhibit, the City of Burlington and the City of Mevin contributed.
Okay.
Well, the City of Graham essentially donates the Captain White House.
They give us funds to help up to keep that up to date.
Right.
It takes a lot of money to keep the house up. We have a lot of traffic through the Captain White House, and that wears on a old house. It's not wasn't built to have
not every day anymore.
Right. Lots of people come through it.
Yeah. Very good. Well, you do a great job keeping it up and promoting, keeping the arts alive here in Alamance County.
So. Well, I appreciate it.
Yep.
All right.
Yep. Thanks.
Good.
Thanks.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Appreciate
okay.
it.
Okay. Next up, we have Tim Walker and Chelsea V.
No Chelsea.
I don't know. That's what was on our sheet of paper. I didn't think.
Actually, this is Jessica Nunn.
I know Jessica. Yes.
And this is Erica Needham. She handles our social media for
okay.
Snow Camp. I'm Tim Walker. So I'm having to drop back and punt a little bit this morning because we prepared for you a 7.5-minute wonderful DVD. But upon arrival, I was told your DVD player's not working. So we have a couple of copies that she's going to share with you guys, and we'll get you another copy so you can take a look at. Basically, the DVD talks about the history of the Snow Camp Outdoor Theater, started in 1969. So since we don't have the DVD, I guess I can start talking, and we can go through each year from 1969 to right now, 47 years.
Give us the clip.
The DVD, you know, was only 7 minutes. But anyway, just to tell you a couple of quick things about what's happening this year. We are expanding our seasons. And so beyond the Sword of Peace and beyond Pathway to Freedom, now we're opening up the amphitheater to other shows that we'll be producing there on site. This year our season will run from July through October. Some other things that are happening, for instance, we have a children's camp that will be running in June that runs for 2 weeks for different ages of children to learn acting and those type of skills. We have two children's shows this year that will be going on. We have a 1940s radio show which will be kind of cool, with music from the 40s. It'll be just like you're going to a radio station there and seeing the music and, you know, the sound effects guy and the whole thing and commercials there, things going on. Also, we have a beautiful play, Love Letters, that'll be going on in the fall. We have a Hee Haw Tribute Show, which will be running for 3 nights in the fall, which will bring in thousands of people because people love that old-time country music, corny jokes, the whole thing, but it's a Hee Haw Tribute Show. And that'll be happening in the fall, which is a beautiful time of the year to be at Snow Camp. Next year, we'll be running our season from April through October. So there will be musicals, there will be different bands and groups that want to use the theater and to also bring more people to Alamance County and more people to be aware of the theater itself. And that's where we are. I think in our request from you is the same as it's been for quite a few years, and we appreciate your partnership over the years, and I hope you enjoy the DVD.
Well, very good.
and that's all I had to say. The DVD was going to tell you the rest, but I do want you to watch the DVD because it's really cool that in the DVD it goes from 1969 and it talks about how it all got started. It talks about Governor Scott, who built the road there, who got the Army Corps of Engineers to clear the property. It talked about Governor Holzhauser being a part of it, and all this history that's down there. And it talks about that historical buildings that are there. When we first started out, there were only 2. Now there are 30 historical buildings there. Old slave houses, first schools in Alamance County. A lot of exciting stuff. And we're going to do Living History Days starting next year. That's going to be out there too, with all the different places out there. And last year also, an Eagle Scout built a new museum that we have tons of old antiques from Alamance County that we were put in there, and that was his Eagle Scout project, and it's probably about half the size of this room, and he did a great job. So we appreciate your commitment to the theater.
I made a mistake. It's yes. Actually supposed to be Chelsea Wilson.
Chelsea Wilson, right.
Is that one of James's
That's his granddaughter. That's exactly okay. Right.
I know Brian, but I don't know her. Is that Brian's daughter?
That's Brian's daughter. Okay. Right, exactly.
Okay, well, that's neat what you do out there. Any questions, sir?
I look forward to seeing the DVD.
Okay. Well, I look forward to you seeing it, too.
All right.
Thank you very much. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jessica. All right. Well, at 10:10, we have no one, and we're right on time. And
we're going to take a break? Or?
Yeah, I think we ought to take a break, and then we'll come back and adjourn. Just kidding. Thanks, guys, for going through this.
I do want to thank you. Yeah. This is 5 days of about 3 hours a day, and I think it is very important. And I know sometimes it takes time to do this, but it's very important, I think, for the agencies that we fund to get in front of you. And sometimes they want to tell their story.
They don't often get the chance, but
they do want to tell their story and of the work that they do for the citizens of Alamance County, and they want to tell you that their tax dollars that you fund them are very valuable and provide those well-needed services.
And they take pride in what they
take
do.
Very
I
much
hear
pride.
That. I've heard that throughout.
They all contribute to the quality of life, and if one thing I've heard over and over about one of the important aspects of economic development and attracting different kinds of businesses here is that we really need to make sure that we have a good quality of life
and be diversified in what we offer. That's true. I mean, you got the Art Council, you got plays, you got a lot of things that will bring people to Alamance County, and hopefully some of them will want to bring their business when they come back or whatever.
I'm looking forward to seeing that DVD.
I know. That's good. I know Mr. Wilson worked hard.
But I do appreciate the board's commitment to this process, and we want to thank you. And just to remind you, the next steps, now the hard work starts for Susan and Andrea and myself, is we have to go back in and have you a balanced budget that we'll present to you on June 6th. As a manager's recommended budget.
That'll be our first meeting, regular meeting.
Yes, sir. With no tax increase is the direction that I'm having.
And then 2 weeks later at our meeting
later,
will be a
public
hearing.
And again, that is one of the things we need to decide where. So we don't have to do that right now, but should we go to Williams or should we go to the historic courthouse? If we need to go either place, I need to go ahead and start, lining that up in that process.
What was the capacity of the courthouse?
It's 175, believe.
I mean, I don't know that we had that many people last year.
We probably could have fit everybody that came to Williams at the courthouse. And that was a controversial budget because you had proposed a 6 cent or 6.5 cent increase or something like that.
Yeah, I don't have way to get into this year, so
thanks, Bob, for bringing that up.
Well, if you're proposing with no tax increase, that may not be, that may not generate as much public interest. I don't know.
If you would like, we can go ahead and schedule the courthouse if the board is.
I think that would be.
I think we should at least do the courthouse.
Okay.
Yeah, not try to do it.
Yes, sir. Right.
Yeah, I would go ahead and schedule that, I think, and.
Okay.
I didn't like Williams High School. It was real hard being on stage.
It's hard to see what people are saying. Yeah. You know, you can't see them nor hear them well.
Yeah, the acoustics on the stage were very echoey. And
right.
People out in the audience could hear the speakers fine, but I had a hard time.
Okay. Well, very good. And with that, we will officially call the budget.